right, well, hello, my name is Dan Bonner, and today I'm going to take you through the final winterization process for our 1999 Palomino yearling. It's now mid-November, and actually, as you look around me, you might be thinking, why isn't he out camping? And I have to admit, I'm kind of feeling the same way. It's going to be 10 or 11 degrees Celsius all weekend, no rain, and as I look here at my wonderful tent trailer or pop-up camper, I am wondering, why am I winterizing? Why am I not camping? But the story behind this is that on our last camping trip, we had tremendous amounts of rain just as we were shutting the trailer down. And unfortunately, it resulted in the cushions and the mattresses and a bunch of other stuff getting wet inside. And I was literally going to the US for business the next day. So sadly, I had to kind of do a pre-winterization at that point. Even with damp rid, and we'll talk about damp rid a little later, there would have been mold, there would have been problems. And although the weather's nice, part of me feels it's smart to winterize while it's nice, and then we'll focus on putting it down for the winter before the weather really changes, because let's be honest, this is unusually nice for Canada for November. As I said, this is a 1999 Palomino yearling. My family, my wife and my two kids, we all refer to the trailer affectionately as Toby, spelt T-O-W-B-Y. It's a pretty lame pun, but anyway, this is our pride and joy. We've had an epic, epic camping season. We did a total of 9 trips from May all the way through to October, but now it's time to get the trailer all set and all ready for its long winter slumber. So first thing I need to do here, because I'm in a storage facility, is I've got to pull the trailer forward a few feet. That's going to do a couple of things. First of all, it's going to give me room to open the back bunk. So one downside to a tent trailer or a pop-up camper, it's you got to open it up to be able to get in it. The other reason I'm going to pull it forward a few feet is that I'm going to put the tires on top of plywood. Tire condition over the winter tends to be a big concern. We'll elaborate on that a little bit later. But I like to back the trailer onto plywood because it helps to keep the frost out of the tires, helps maintain the condition of the tire over the winter. It does pose a bit of an issue with flat spots. I suppose you could, every now and then in the winter, jack the trailer up, rotate the wheel, lower it back down again to prevent that. But I've stored it this way for, this is the fourth or fifth winter, never had a flat spot, never had a problem with the tire. So it's the other reason we're going to tow the trailer forward. So I'm going to hook up the van, bring her forward a few feet, start opening her up, and then we'll talk more about winterization. So we towed the trailer out, as you can see, just a few feet, give us enough clearance just to slide that back bed out. I don't really need it to come all the way out. I just needed it far enough to be able to get the dinette folded up, and the front bed, I haven't pulled it out all the way, just far enough to clear the space. Safety tip, of course, do not climb on the bunks unless they are fully extended with the support poles underneath them. You could easily damage the trailer big time. I don't really intend to crawl around on there. My main purpose today is to get the rest of the interior all set. Have noticed a bit of a maintenance concern. This is common, I'm guessing, in not just Palominos, but a lot of different trailers. There is a rubber seal that runs around the top of the lid, I guess you could call it, or the roof. And I noticed that today when I was removing the clamp there, there was quite a bit of flex. And it's a little hard to see, but up in the back there, the wood has actually started to rot. Now, I knew last year that it wasn't sealing that well, so I put some weather stripping, closed foam or closed cell weather stripping. Problem with that is that once you clamp the lid down, it squishes it, and after that, it's not too practical. It's all right if you close it, leave it closed, but yeah, I think I need to get on the phone. You can order it for about $1 a foot from the manufacturer, plus shipping. Didn't really want to do that job before the winter, but that inner surface up there, there's wood, chipboard, running across the back of the aluminum skin there, and it's going to rot out. So that's more maintenance I'm going to have to do. The canvas is dirty on the outside, absolutely. This being the back end of the trailer, this is the area that always gets the worst bugs, sap, debris from trees, moisture. I actually have an amazing mildew product from Bass Pro. It's specifically designed for vinyl, and you literally can squirt it all over the vinyl in the spring, let it soak for a couple of minutes, rinse it off, and this will be as clean as a whistle. So I don't have water facilities here at the storage lot. I'll have to do that at my in-laws' place. but this stuff will all come off. I know that probably horrifies some of you to think that you're gonna leave it that way, but this is my fourth season and it hasn't damaged the vinyl, and all of this dirt comes off easily. So biggest priority with winterizing, your two biggest things that you have to be concerned of is moisture and mice. Those are your two biggest concerns. Moisture is your number one problem because you have canvas. Well, it's not really canvas. It's kind of a canvas with a vinyl backing, but everybody refers to it as canvas. That can get moldy. I've got a little bit of mold on this back one that I'm going to have to clean up in the spring. A lot of the marks that you see on the inside of our trailer is actually oxidization. On the older trailers, the aluminum shepherd's crooks and the aluminum bed bows, those are the pipes sort of things that you see there, they oxidize and you get a black crap coming off of them. Newer trailers, those are actually powder coated so that you don't have that dirt. But yeah, moisture and mice. So in terms of moisture, how do we combat moisture in a tent trailer? Well, this product right here, as the British would say, is a godsend. This is called Damp Rid. D-A-M-P, excuse me, R-I-D. It's basically a, there's a proper term for it, begins with a D. But anyway, it absorbs moisture out of the air in an almost industrial sense. And then the liquid pools in the bottom of the container. And you can actually dispose of that down your toilet. Damp Rid is amazing. I bought these containers several years ago, and then now I just buy the bag with the crystals. But when we closed the trailer down after that monsoon rain a few weeks ago, there was no way I could leave the trailer closed up without Damp Rid. One of the things that you may notice when you own a tent trailer or a pop-up camper is a lot of condensation on the ceiling. If moisture has got in, or if it's been exceedingly damp when you shut the trailer down, bad idea. I mean, that can cause mold and all kinds of damage. So we threw the Damp Rid in. Don't usually put it in until the winter time, but this was necessary. And I gotta tell you, it smells a tiny bit musty in here, but it is bone dry. It is absolutely bone dry. And this has been closed up now for, like I said, 2 to 3 weeks. If I sound out of breath, it's because I'm out of shape. And setting this trailer up in a hurry is hard work. But anyway, I also put the Damp Rid in these larger containers because, heaven forbid, if the trailer should get bumped or something in the winter, you don't want that tipping over and all that chemical water pouring all over your floor and damaging the floor in the trailer. So even though it's got a catch basin, I always recommend putting it in two containers like this. And I've got our trailer is 7 foot wide, 12 foot box, and I use three, and they last us throughout the winter. And as my father-in-law likes to say, it's as dry as a popcorn fart in here in the springtime. So moisture is your biggest concern. In that same vein as moisture, you'll notice I have no curtains. The valance is still up, the window treatments, but those don't, I don't take those down. But the curtains are out, the mattresses are out, and the cushions are out. And I store those in my basement. It's a bit of a pain lugging the mattresses from the trailer all the way into the back of the van, but it is well worth it because they're sponge, they're fabric, they're gonna soak up any excess moisture that the Damp Rid doesn't get to, and it will damage them. So highly recommend that you find somewhere indoors, nice and dry in the winter months, to store your cushions, your curtains and such. And you can gently wash the curtains. I wash them in our washing machine on a gentle cycle, and then I air dry them. They're fabric with a vinyl backer, so they don't get moldy. And then that way they're nice and fresh, gets rid of cooking smells. I think you'd probably have to use a carpet cleaner or like a Febreze to freshen up the mattresses. The covers don't come off of ours, but the cushions they do. And I think this is the first year I'm actually gonna take those cushion covers off. I'll show you that in another video actually give them a gentle wash. So moisture is your number one thing. Something I will be mentioning that I'm not gonna deal with today though is sealing the roof. A little bit later I'll show you the seals on the roof. You always wanna check your caulking in the spring and in the fall. Because if you're going to get any moisture coming in, it's going to damage this roof inside. So that's something else to consider. The other big thing we need to combat, mice. Mice, especially if you're near a field like I am like this, you hear horror stories and you see horror stories about mice getting into trailers, destroying the canvas, shredding it. This is a one-piece sort of canvas all the way around, you're looking at thousands of dollars to replace, folks. You do not want mice getting in here. So taking the cushions out and the mattresses and the curtains also helps, because one, you're getting rid of the cooking smell that might attract mice. Secondly, they love to make nests with foam and fabrics. If you take that out of here, pretty good chance that that's going to cut down on the chances of you getting mice. A couple other things that we'll show you a little bit later. My first priority right now, though, is this ceiling. I am going to clean this ceiling with a magic eraser because it's got a little mildewy, but a lot of the stains you're seeing are bug guts. It seems invariable that we camp in places that have a lot of bugs. My wife hates bugs, so she spends a lot of time with a fly swatter killing them and making a mess, and I don't like to leave it that way. So a little bit of water, a little bit of elbow grease, and we're going to clean this up with a magic eraser. What I'm doing is I've got my magic eraser and a little bit of moisture, and all I'm doing is just going across the ceiling and just wiping off the debris. Now the magic eraser is great because this Luon board, that's this very thin board that's got like a plastic coating, maybe it's vinyl, it has a texture. And if you've ever tried to clean your fridge, if you have a textured old white fridge, you know it's a nightmare to get the dirt out. But the melamine foam in the magic eraser can get right up in all the little crevices. Now I do this again in the spring when I de-winterize, and next spring we'll post a video of that. I do this again, and I do it a couple of times in the season too. The melamine does not damage the Luon, or at least it's never damaged mine, and I've been at this for a few years. It leaves everything nice and clean, and it just smells and looks a lot nicer in the spring. These marks here are from adhesive tape. I tried to put a smoke detector up there. I now have it mounted here instead. I always freak out thinking, oh my God, got tremendous mold, but no, it's just from the adhesive. Top tip, you know, roof ceiling and leaks is another nightmare scenario for any tent trailer owner. If you start to notice that your staples in the ceiling are rusting, or this paneling is getting spongy or bubbling or blistering, that is almost a guarantee, folks, that you've got water coming in. And a little bit later in the video, we'll take a look at the caulking on the trailer, and we'll talk about a little bit about patching that up. But that's a surefire sign that you've got water ingress coming in from somewhere, and that's bad news. So anyway, we'll keep going. We'll clean up the ceiling as best as we can.
And we'll move on to the next portion of the cleaning first when I winterize, because you can't really see it, but in some of the spots behind me, there's a little bit of moisture left from where I've been wiping it with the magic eraser. So I've got my vent cover. I've got it all opened up, and I've got the door open. That way it'll breathe and it'll dry out, because although I've got the damper aid, you don't want to be adding tremendous amounts of moisture. Another top tip for you, see my door there that folds down? That panel does seal up. I leave it open. That way the air can circulate, because what happens is, behind me here, the door mounts up there. And if you have a door that mounts in the ceiling, and I think nearly all tent trailers do, you run the risk of having moisture get trapped between the door and the roof. So you want to make sure that the air can sort of circulate through there. So we're going to give that a wipe down. And like I said, this is the first thing I'm doing. That way a lot of this moisture will dry off by the time I'm done. The side windows, they're a little dirty. I might give them a little bit of a wipe down in a couple of spots. As I said, this trailer was shut down in very, very wet conditions, which is, you should never really do that. Unfortunately, in this storage facility, I got limited space. I was going to the US for a week. The idea of leaving the tent trailer set up in the storage facility, even though it's gated, even though it's got razor wire, really didn't sit well with me. So I kind of broke one of the cardinal rules that you never ever put a trailer away wet. But taking the cushions out, putting the damper it in, seemed to do the trick. So almost
ready for the next step. I've cleaned the ceiling behind the door. I've now got it latched back in place. What I chose to do, I got to fix my screen a little bit in the spring, is I've left this panel open. So you got a pretty good space there. Allows the air to travel up behind it. It's also going to allow the damp rid over the course of the winter to pull any excess moisture that traps behind the door and prevent that from getting
too dirty and too gross before spring.
Earlier we were talking about things that we removed from the trailer. We were talking about the cushions and the mattresses. Something else I should point out about removing things. I like to take out any bedding, of course, which is not in here currently, but I noticed that we still have some sleeping bags that were here in the trailer. We also have a couple of space heaters. Our unit doesn't have a furnace, so we use two little plug-in space heaters in the early spring and fall when we camp if it's cold. I like to take those out. Anything electronic like that, I'd rather not leave inside. But camping chairs, we have a screen house down there. We have a gazebo to put over an outdoor kitchen. That stuff stays in the trailer. Basically anything that could be damaged by severe cold or moisture, you really don't want to leave it inside the trailer if you can help it. And it's always a good idea just to go through your different storage compartments. Just quickly look for stuff. I noticed we had a bunch of batteries in the one drawer here. Probably not an issue, but I don't want the batteries bursting or leaking some sort of chemical all over the trailer. So taking those out as well. The next thing we should talk about in terms of winterizing is, of course, your water system. Now, I am not going to give you instructions on bypassing your water heater. We don't have one in this trailer. Our trailer literally has a pump tap, which is currently inoperable, and a 10 or 12 gallon onboard water tank. And basically, you fill it from the outside, you use the pump tap, and it squirts, emphasis on squirts, water into the sink. Let me show you something. The first things that went wrong this season when I was de-winterizing was the little flipper arm on the side here broke off. So this tap is actually inoperable. Normally, when you winterize, you want to make sure that you put an RV-grade antifreeze into the water system. Common sense there is if you live in a place like we do here in Canada, it can get down to, minus 10, minus 20 Celsius. If there's any water in those plastic pipes going up to the tap, they will burst and damage the water system, leak water everywhere, and that's just bad news. Also, the tank, which is underneath this bench, you also, if you have any leftover water in there, you want to make sure that the antifreeze has been added. A little bit of a moot point this year because the tap doesn't even work, so what I'm probably going to have to do is lift the tap up. Long story about the tape, I'll explain that another time. And make sure that the line is drained. Normally, I would fill the antifreeze in the tank, pump the tap enough times that we get some pink antifreeze coming out. That's not going to be possible because the tap doesn't work. So we'll have to improvise, probably pull the line off underneath and just make sure that any moisture drains out. But putting RV antifreeze in your water system is a critical step. If you have an onboard water heater, there's a lot of other videos out there on how to bypass that and safely winterize your water heater. We don't even have a 12-volt pump. Onboard pump for this system. I have heard some folks using compressed air to blow out the system versus using the antifreeze, but quite honestly, the antifreeze has worked well for us. So you can buy it at any Canadian Tire, Home Depot, Lowe's, places like that. Make sure it is an RV grade antifreeze. It's non-toxic. It's not the antifreeze you put in your car. And we'll go outside in a few moments and add some of that to the tank. So that we can
see our water connections. This is actually our drain connection here. You can put a little bit of antifreeze down it if you want. It's basically, for ours, it's a flexible tube, and then you hook a hose onto here into a waste receptacle. I don't typically put any antifreeze in that. This is your city water connection. If you're at a campground with water hookups, you can hook in a RV-grade white drinking hose, pressurizes the system. Hasn't been used in a couple of years because of the tap. Quite honestly, it's garbage, so I'm not going to worry about that. What I'm going to do is open up this. This is your fresh water fill cap, and I'm going to add some of this. This is RV plumbing antifreeze rated down to minus 50. I got this, I want to say, at Home Depot, but most hardware stores and RV supply stores this time of year are going to carry this, and it is non-toxic. In our spring video that we'll do where we de-winterize, we'll talk about making the system taste a little better, but I haven't decided yet what I'm going to do about the pump tap. Part of me wants to just buy another pump tap and be done with it. Part of me wants to put a 12-volt pump in, but we haven't really decided, so. One thing that is really advisable, get yourself a funnel. I picked this up at a dollar store. It's got a nice flexible tail on it. Whoever designed these water things should be shot. I mean, good luck
with the angle that's on, trying to pour this in there without having it piss all over the ground. Whereas if you put a funnel in like this, you can hold the funnel with one hand, pour it in with the other, and not have a problem. Now, normally I would add quite a bit. This thing was full. You can see that this is how much I used last winter. They say use a ton of it. I really don't need to, as long as I've got about quarter inch or so in the bottom of the storage tank and I've got enough in the water lines. That's always been good for me. And then you drain it out in the spring. Now I do have a drain, a low point drain. Technically you should open that up and let the antifreeze run through that. Again, because I haven't used my water system in such a long time, there's probably nothing in there to be concerned about. But yeah, let it run out of your low point drain, just a dribble. And that way you should be okay. So, can't really hold the camera and do this. But basically, like I said, just gonna put the funnel in, like so. Dump, probably half of what's still in that container into the tank, and then decide what I'm going to do on the inside.
But you come back into the camper, you would open your faucet. In this case, you would pump the faucet till the pink liquid starts to come out, open up the drain, let it flow through. But in the spring, a bunch of things on the trailer broke. This has been a season of problems and things busting, and this was one of them. The little flapper arm broke off. I tried to use a screw drilled through it. I tried to also use an epoxy, but the amount of pressure that arm is on, it didn't work. You can buy a replacement pump tap like this from Palomino. Last time I checked, around $30, $40 plus shipping. I'll be honest, folks, I can pee harder than this thing comes out. One of the things that we've done this season is we put our stove right here, our 3-burner gas stove, and I've actually put a large water canister, one of those blue water tanks, on top of it with the spigot right over the sink. Most places we camp at, the provincial parks, they don't have individual water hookups. You have a shared water tap, so you end up going back and filling that anyway. Works perfectly, and you get more pressure than you do coming out of this tap. Now, the tape. Well, we borrowed the screws for an emergency frame repair. I'll save that for another video, but the front corner of the trailer literally pulled apart and we had to repair it and realize that I didn't buy the right length screws. They were too long and I didn't want them punching straight through to the outside of the trailer. And there were 4 perfect size screws right here holding the tap in place. So we improvised a little bit of bush maintenance and took the screws out and then use this Gorilla tape to hold the tap down. But what I think I'm going to do is see if I can pull this tap all the way through. I don't think that's going to work. I'm going to have to come at it from underneath. Remove the water line that's going into it, and then that will hopefully allow any moisture to drain back into the tank. The tank underneath this bench now has the antifreeze in it, so really that should be good for what we need to do.
That's the bottom of the sink and that's your drain hose. We've got this hose here. This one here that goes into the onboard tank. And then this is your pressurized line that is for your city water. I was going to go underneath here and remove, let me shorten my selfie stick here. Here we go. Oh, geez. Sorry about that, guys. We'll edit that out. I was going to remove this Jubilee clip, this hose clamp, and then remove this line so that any moisture would drain out, but there doesn't appear to be any suction on that line. That line is absolutely bone dry. There's nothing in it. So there's absolutely no risk of any moisture in there causing the line to burst. Last winter, you would have seen this whole thing pink because I would have pumped the tap to pull all of the water up the pipe and then eventually pull the antifreeze up the pipe so the tap and everything else was protected against the elements. But in light of the fact that everything in here is bone dry, there really is no need for me to do that. So, waterization, or winterization water, I should say.
In the video, we were talking about the two biggest things that are a risk to a trailer in the winter. One of them being moisture. We've tackled a certain amount of that. The other one is being mice. And a couple of tips and tricks for that. The first one we mentioned, removing the cushions, removing the curtains, the mattresses, less stuff for them to make a nest in. The other thing you want to try and do is minimize cooking smells. So make sure that you wipe down your stove, wipe down your counters, make sure your fridge is cleaned out, and I'll check the fridge in a minute, give it a bit of a wipe down. But the other thing you can do
which I'm actually going to do, and this has worked really, really well. Two of your other best defenses against mice, dryer sheets. Probably going to get sued for all the name brands on this video, but anyway, wonderful dryer sheets, free advertising. And then steel wool. Now this is a 0000 grade, or quadruple O. I don't know what the proper term would be. I'm not a tech person. But this is a very, very fine grade. In fact, I think it's the finest grade steel wool you can buy. This stuff is amazing. And what we do with the steel wool is we go around the outside of the camper and any of the outlets for the gas hookups, electrical hookups, anything like that, you can actually put this stuff inside there. And it's one of the few things that mice will not chew through. If they do eat any of it, it kills them very quickly. This is fantastic stuff. I've used it every year. The combination of the steel wool and, of course, like I said, the dryer sheets is phenomenal. Now, the dryer sheets, they're there for scent. I mean, these are Country Meadow scent, and even right now, they're pretty potent. And I will literally sprinkle almost this entire box throughout the camper. I'll put it in the storage areas under the benches. I'll put it in the fridge. I'll put it in where the dinette is hollow. I'll put a few on the floor. And it works wonderfully because the smell, the mice don't like it. It really stinks for them. And in the springtime, when you open up the trailer, of course, rather than smelling just like mustiness, it's going to smell like dryer sheets. So amazing top tip. I don't do mouse traps. I do sometimes put mouse baits inside so that worst case scenario, if a mouse does get into the trailer, it's going to be attracted to the bait, eat the poison, and die. That's not pretty. I mean, can you imagine having a decomposing dead mouse in your trailer all winter? I guess here in Canada, it would be frozen, but if you don't catch it quickly enough, that's disgusting. My thought process is, let's do the steel wool first. So let's go around the trailer and I'll show you where we put the steel wool. So a couple of places you want to really watch out for. Mice can get into the tiniest of openings. So really you want to go through your entire camper and you want to look for anywhere where a mouse could potentially get in. So one of the common places where a mouse might get in are these doors that open up. And actually you can see I've got some old steel wool in there from last winter. This is the outside barbecue point. There's a propane hose that comes out of there. You'll notice though that I've got the steel wool along the bottom. Now the previous owner of the trailer put one of these scrubbies. Same kind of concept, but this stuff is, I think, is better. It's a little tougher. And the only problem with it, of course, is that you'll notice with the moisture, it does rust and it does leave a little bit of rust stains. This is not damaging the trailer, really. It's just staining it. A little bit of hot soapy water, you'll get most of that off of there. But I don't know about you, I'd rather have orange stains in some of my little doors here than have a mouse potentially get in there. I'll probably pack a little more fresh steel wool in there, and then basically I like to push the door shut and make sure that, okay, like that has a little bit too much give to it, that it's packed pretty tight, and then when we close that door down, the mouse isn't really going to be able to get in there. And if it is trying to get in there, it's going to try and chew through this first, and that will kill it. I would recommend topping up your damp rid, especially if it's going to be the last part of the season. These containers should really be full right to the top, but you can already see how in the course of a few weeks since our last trip, the damp rid has done its job and absorbed a ton of moisture. Here in Canada, the damp rid really is mostly there for the fall, when there's a lot of rain, when you first close up the trailer, but also in the spring. When it's minus 20 and snowing, and I sit at home daydreaming about camping, I take solace in knowing that, you know, there's not going to be any moisture in the trailer at minus 20. Trust me, folks, if you don't live in a cold climate, when it's winter and minus 20, there's a yellow jacket there, wasp, just keeping my distance. What am I trying to spit out here? In the winter, when it's minus 20, you don't really get a lot of moisture. The air is very, very dry, so it's not usually an issue. But in those two periods, like I said, the fall and the spring, the last thing you want to have happen is a lot of moisture in here. It can destroy the inside of a trailer, and you will often get condensation. First time I saw it, I thought, oh my God, I got a leak. The whole ceiling was wet, but it was not like wet, like a bucket of water wet. It was like you just got out of a shower wet, and it was literally just differences in air temperature. The trailer inside was cold,
the sun was beating down on it, creating a temperature variance, and then of course you were getting moisture. So I can't stress enough, damp rid is the best possible investment. Yes, you can buy other moisture absorbers on the market, but damp rid is absolutely the best. Another thing I'm going to do is clean up the floor. We do sweep the floor on a pretty regular basis when we camp, and occasionally we will mop it up. You can see that I had a tear happen in the floor a couple of years ago, which I fixed with some vinyl flooring glue, and then we put a mat over top of it. It's on the honey-do list. I could rip up the entire floor or redo it, but it's a camper, folks. It's not a palace. We put a nice little mat over top of it. Nobody ever notices. But one of the things I like to do just before the season is completely done and before we winterize is I like to clean the floor. So sweep it as well as go ahead and mop it and clean it up. Two things. I mean, it's, you know, clean and tidy so that it's nice for when you open it in the spring. But secondly, again, it's the whole mouse thing, stopping any scents attracting the mice. So that's going to be the next thing. I'm going to take a few things out of here, sweep out the excess dirt. Whoa, there goes the yellow jacket. Thank God he's out of there. And then give it a little bit of a mop down. Now, you could use Mop and Glow. You can use any vinyl floor cleaner. My wife is obsessed with using stuff that's safer. So we've got a mixture of hot water, vinegar, and a little bit of eucalyptus oil for scent. That'll be fine. That will clean the floor and keep it looking pretty good. I'll mop it in a second, but before I do that, there's no sense in me walking around a lot in here and getting a bunch of dirt. So I'll mop it in a second, is the fridge. Now, this is a little small 2 or 3 foot cubic fridge. You'll notice it's a little gross inside, and that's probably because we used it a few weeks ago. And as I said, it was very damp, very rainy. So one of the things I'm going to do is use some wipes. These are Lysol antibacterial wipes. And basically just wipe the inside of the fridge down. I don't want any moisture or mold or smells building up in there. It's not very sanitary for one thing. And secondly, again, yes, I sound paranoid, but mice, you know, again, you don't want any food smells. Now, this does have a latch right here. It's a latch that turns and rotates. And the point of the latch, in case you're wondering, A, it can stop the door opening in transit. There's a little latch here on the top of the door. You can close the door and secure it with the latch to stop the fridge door opening in transit like that. Now you'll notice the door can't open. But what I prefer the whole process for is to stop the door closing. So if I twist it over like this, gotta remember to keep the camera where you can see it. You notice the door can't close all the way. I've got a good, along the back here, a good inch gap. And that's an air gap to allow air to circulate in there. You never want to leave this thing sealed up. In fact, every time we come home from a camping trip or we close the trailer down at the end of a camping trip, I make sure that the latch is in that position there. So again, when we shut the fridge, it can't push all the way shut and it keeps it fairly clean. Now, it's a little gross right now because we had a bit of a panic on the last camping trip. I'm just going to take the Lysol wipes and just give it a little bit of a wipe down. So, not really going to show you that. I'm sure you get the gist, but it's another top tip.
I'm going to wipe out the fridge. I know I said I wasn't going to show you this, but I figured, you know what? It'll give me a chance to sit down, and it will give me a chance to rest my legs a bit and talk to you guys a little bit. We've owned this tent trailer now for, like I said, about 4 years. We started out in tents, moved up to the Popup Camper, and we love it. We absolutely love it. We only really get 6 months of the year to go out camping here in Canada, so we make the absolute best of it, and I love camping. And I'll go into more detail on another video that I'm going to put together over the course of the winter about why I love camping so much. But I just wanted to say that this winterizing process can usually be kind of depressing for us, or for me especially, just because it is the end of the season. You know, I love camping. I love spending time with my family, my wife, and my kids. And it's always kind of bittersweet. You sit here in the trailer and you think about all the memories. You can hear the laughter of your kids, laughter of your wife. You can smell the campfire. You can smell the amazing food and the breakfasts. My wife's an amazing cook, makes some amazing food. And all the memories that you've made. And it is a little sad to think that, okay, this is it, you know, we're done for the season. 6 months or 5 or 6 months, this trailer is going to be closed up, and basically out of commission. And we're not really into skiing or snowboarding or anything like that, so we just sit around and get fat all winter and dream of camping. So after we get the trailer closed down, in terms of maintenance, there won't really be much to do. I do like to come and keep the snow and the ice cleared off the trailer. A top tip for winter time is don't ever let a lot of ice and snow build up on the top of your trailer roof, your camper roof. These roofs, or roofs, as my American friends would say, I haven't actually seen the framework in them. I'd imagine it's pretty flimsy, and then it's a thin aluminum skin, or aluminium, as they say in the UK. It doesn't take a lot of weight to damage that, especially if you get a sudden thaw, and then you get a refreeze, and you get that weight. So whenever possible, I like to come over and just pull any of the light, fluffy snow off the roof, and just make sure that everything's good. There's no signs of the roof caving in or anything like that. My father-in-law often says to me, well, you know, if there was a problem, like the roof caved in, what are you going to do in the winter? Well, good point, touche. You probably couldn't fix it, but preventative maintenance, it also gives you an excuse to come out and daydream and think about all the camping trips ahead and all the excitement and fun. We would eventually like to upgrade to a hybrid trailer, and in a video that we're going to put together over the winter months, I'm going to talk about the benefits, in my opinion, of having a hybrid over a tent trailer. But one of the single biggest things would be exactly what I'm going through right now, which is, you know, it's October, it's really nice outside, and we're not camping. And it's because of the rain issue that we encountered the last time we camped that we had to suddenly pull everything out. If the mattresses and the curtains, if everything was still in the trailer in good shape, we'd totally be out camping. We'd be booked in at the Pinery, which is a amazing provincial park near here. And we'd be making the best of it. You know, you got, like I said, 6 months of winter. Why wouldn't you get out and camp while you can? And if we had a hybrid, wouldn't have been a big deal. But with the tent trailer, it's a fair weather piece of equipment. It's not really designed for cold camping. And its biggest enemy, aside from mice, like we said, is moisture. And that rain just did a real number on things. So it's a catch-22. Part of you wants to camp, but part of you also realizes that, hey, we did a good thing catching the moisture and dealing with it when we did. And if we'd left it, it could be catastrophic. And let's be honest, do I really want to be hauling all those mattresses and cushions back up out of the basement, putting them back in the trailer just to do one more camping trip? And my answer, honestly, folks, is no. So the fridge is all wiped out as best as I can. It's not spotless. There's some marks in there that aren't quite coming out, but I'm pretty satisfied. It smells good that it's cleared out. The only thing I'll do now is wipe down the countertops. And then we're going to start getting our dryer sheets and sprinkling them throughout the trailer. So that'll be the next
part. Got our dryer sheets, and we're going to start sprinkling them throughout the trailer. First place I'm going to put them is in the fridge now that it's been cleaned out a little better, wiped down. We'll put a couple of dryer sheets in there that will counteract any smells that might attract mice. We'll put a couple in this storage compartment. This is the electrical compartment. We'll put a couple in there. I'll probably put a couple in this storage compartment. This is our dinette. So there's usually cushions here, and then the table under here folds out to make a dinette. This is your outside storage compartment. So we'll put some dryer sheets in there. Also show you a tip about getting rid of moisture in that compartment as well. And then in the back, we've got a U-shaped dinette with a table that also turns into a bed. And I will open up each of those compartments. A little tricky because I don't have the back bunk all the way out, but I'll open them up and I'll put dryer sheets underneath as well. Probably put some in the cupboards as well. I don't really put them on the floors per se. I mostly put them in areas where the mice would probably get in from the outside. Something else I've done, which maybe it's overkill, we mentioned the steel wool earlier. I will sometimes shove steel wool through here, these openings. This is where you put your finger in to pull the compartment door open. But let's be honest, I mean, a mouse is probably just going to pull that right out of there. But I don't know, just peace of mind knowing that your trailer's protected while you're gone. So that's the next step, dryer sheets. Nice, easy solution for a couple of bucks.
So let's do a quick review of what we've done so far to winterize the trailer.
We made sure that the curtains, cushions, and mattresses were removed. We also removed any sleeping bags, any electronic items, anything electrical that we didn't want to leave in the trailer. That's been taken out. Unlike a regular travel trailer where you can get in and out of it easily, once this thing's closed down, it's closed down. So you want to make sure that anything that needs to be retrieved is done now before the winter. We cleaned the ceiling with a magic eraser to get rid of any mildew or any bug guts that might have been sticking up there. We swept and mopped the linoleum floor. We put dryer sheets in all the storage compartments. I'm 3 or 4 per compartment, really don't want to have to go overboard. We ran around the outside of the trailer and we plugged up any outside ports and openings with very fine steel wool to prevent mice getting in. The damp rid is all ready to go in its containers. So the next step is going to be to close the trailer down, get it all sealed up, and then we'll do the finishing touches, and that'll be it for winterizing. Let's talk about some other preventative measures that you should also do. First of all, don't litter. We'll edit that out. Two other big things that you want to be mindful of. If you have an awning bag like this one, take that off of there. Ours is affixed with, there's a channel here with a plastic sort of stem that runs through. There's 3 Robinson, I guess you'd call them, square-headed screws. Here's the third one. I'm going to take those out. I store them in a little baggie in the storage compartment here, and then I'm going to slide the entire bag right off the trailer, and I'll actually put this in my basement. That way, it's not staying outside on the trailer over the winter months. Other things you should always check, of course, is your seams, your caulking. You can use a Turnabond tape. What I typically do is I just go along and look for any cracks, any breaks, and then I would clean away. The original owner had put silicone here, not really the best stuff. Peel it away, clean it up with some rubbing alcohol, and redo the caulking, and you can kind of see the different areas where I've touched it up. I'll probably go over this again in a few days before we're completely done, but a good idea to stop any moisture getting into the trailer. Another job that I'm going to do today is I'm going to take off my Max Vent air cover, or Max Air vent cover, let's get this right, and I'm going to attempt to use some what they call lap sealant. And the lap sealant will help prevent any leaks from getting into the roof of the trailer. So that's another little job that I'm going to do. But yeah, I like to make sure on a nice warm day like this that the caulking is all done. Now, I must admit, this is a messy job. We had some issues last year with the type of caulking I was using, and the weather kind of turned ugly, so I ended up just kind of splooging it on there, and it looks terrible. It's attracted a lot of dirt, but you know what, it has not leaked. The inside is bone dry. The only area of concern that we have this year, of course, is that we've got some sponginess. If you look here as I'm pushing on this, it's solid up here, but under here it's very spongy. That's a very bad sign. Basically what's happened is the rubber seal's no good, the water's got in, and it's, you can see as I put the clamp on and off, it's literally moving this entire piece. That's gonna rip out right out of there if we're not careful. So that has to be addressed in the next few days. Same thing all the way down here, checking the seam, making sure it's good to go. The last thing that I'll do, and I'll show you a quick shot of this when I'm done, we alluded to this earlier, when I reverse the trailer, I'll get it close to position as to where it needs to be, and then I've got some plywood planks. I'll slip them in behind the wheels, back it up a couple more inches so that it's centered on the plywood, chalk the wheels again, and that'll protect the wheels. Now, while we're on the subject of wheels, some people will buy covers to put over top of the wheels to protect them against UV. Very good idea, because it stops the sidewalls of the tires degrading. I don't do that here, because if you look right now, it's the middle of the afternoon, and this is almost entirely in shade. Same if we go on the other side. And I've really monitored this very closely, and there's very, very little direct ultraviolet light getting onto these tires. So I personally don't do covers, but you could if you wanted to. The plywood, I guess the philosophy there is that it stops the frost from getting into the tires. So all I gotta do now is to put the steadies up and get the trailer ready to back up. I'm not sure if I'm gonna be able to reach the max vent today. So I may do that in a later video, because yeah, my arms are pretty short, so I'm probably gonna need a step stool for that. But anyway, that really concludes it. By no means professing to be an expert here, I'm just sharing with you the tips and tricks that have worked well for me over the last 4 years, and other than a little bit of maintenance here and there, my trailer has lasted really, really well. It's just by, you know, going on messaging boards like Popup Portal and learning from the fine folks over there. But this little bit of maintenance will mean that when you de-winterize this Popup Camper in the spring, you have a lot less work to do. So I hope you've enjoyed. If you have any questions, pop them in the comments below. And if you haven't already, please do subscribe, and have a great, happy, and safe winter. Let's plan for camping 2017.